I still remember my first playthrough of Bioshock like it was yesterday, despite it being over a decade ago. I was still in college and a buddy of mine owned it for his PS3. When I shared my interest while discussing it, he explained that I could come play through it anytime I wanted. If memory serves me correctly, that weekend he went out of town and I basically spent the entire time not only in that cold, dark dorm room, but also in Rapture. I came into Bioshock knowing very little, only what I had seen from trailers. The idea of shooting lightning from my hands and fighting my way through a horror survival sounded fun to me, but I wasn't totally prepared for the adventure that waited for me below the waves. Even now, over 10 years later, I still catch myself fondly reminiscing about my first trek through the crumbling society of Andrew Ryan. Even more recently, I started to play through Prey with friends and discussing the aspects of the gameplay and story as we went, and every time I played, all I could think about was Bioshock. So I decided to, once again, dive into the depths of the sea to experience Rapture with a fresh perspective. It feels a bit silly to have a spoiler warning for a game that is over a decade old, but the truth is that Bioshock is best experienced going into it knowing as little as possible. I will be discussing a lot of information that will spoil just about every aspect of the game, so this warning is obligatory. It's my personal opinion that the absolute best part of Bioshock is the opening. In fact, I would go so far as to say that I think it's one of the most enthralling and captivating openings in gaming history. I must clarify that by opening, I more so mean the opening act or section of the game, rather than the brief animated cutscene at the very beginning. We take the airplane seat of Jack, saying a few lines of generic dialogue, and without warning or explanation, the plane crashes in the ocean. We find ourselves swimming to the surface and gasping for air, the only things around us being debris from our plane, and an ominous, mysterious tower. With no other clear path of safety, we head towards the tower, take a look inside, and are greeted with a banner and a statue, the banner reading, "No gods or kings, only man." If this nor the large idol-like statue are clear enough indicators of what the themes of the game are, it will only take a moment for them to become black and white. Upon entering a large submarine-like device, we are lowered down while given a compelling speech and slideshow from none other than Andrew Ryan himself. In the middle of this speech, the slideshow disappears, revealing the astonishing sight that is Rapture, an underwater city that seems impossible, especially for the timeline that Bioshock is set in, the 1960s. The music crescendos upon this reveal, and we are left awestruck at this Atlantean submerged world. However, all of the verbose speeches and breathtaking views are quickly sunk as we enter the city and immediately watch a stranger ruthlessly murdered by a crazed lunatic. After, the psychopath turns to us and attempts to break into our underwater craft to no avail, but due to the suggestion of a stranger with seemingly good intentions, the door opens, we step out, and the journey begins. The juxtaposition between the lofty rhetoric of Andrew Ryan and the visceral visual display of the reality of Rapture is jarring, to say the least. Within a few seconds, we are told that this city is a paradigm of progress, with morality thrown to the wind for the sake of freedom, just to immediately see what that kind of moral freedom has brought to its citizens. Just to quickly recap, we are dropped into the ocean after a mysterious plane crash. We find refuge in an inexplicable lighthouse conveniently placed in the middle of the ocean. We have the philosophy of an egocentric idealist presented before us. We are mystified by a submerged metropolis. We witness firsthand the brutal murder of a stranger, only to have the insane assailant turn to us to no avail, and then we are simply let out into the dangerous biome. I distinctly remember having a genuine hesitation to even take the first step out of the bathysphere when I first played. So much information was thrown at me all at once. Now with this splicer, presumably waiting for me in the shadows to gut me like a fish. Before I ventured out for the first time, my mind was filled with terrified questions. Can I just go back up? I don't have anything to defend myself just yet. Will the game still throw enemies at me? What else waits for me in the dark in this dystopian hellscape that is Rapture? However, while I was a bit more shaken than my yesteryear's ego would like for me to admit, I couldn't just not continue after this kind of opening. I was utterly hooked by the themes and atmosphere already displayed. As terrified as I may have been, I was doubly intrigued and curious about what lies ahead. I had to know more about this world, Andrew Ryan, and the ideas the story wanted to explore. For years after playing Bioshock, I've heard a lot of discussions about the game and its meaning in relation to the story and subtext. There have been discussions about objectivism and capitalism. There have been the obvious comparisons between Ayn Rand's work, most notably Atlas Shrugged, and its connection to the plot. And while those topics certainly merit discussion, the underlying theme that has always stuck out to me the most is the risks and rewards of total freedom, and even perhaps the illusion of freedom. While this freedom from governments or even morality has obviously left Rapture as a nightmarish wasteland, I think it's unfair to look past the advancements that it has allowed as well. Remember that Bioshock takes place in the 1960s, yet there is technology here that, even in the 21st century, looks like nothing short of a wondrous miracle. While it's easy to marvel at flying security robots that possess the ability to identify, target, and fire upon enemies, or perhaps the general engineering prowess required to build an underwater city, the scientific advancement that is most notable is in the form of plasmids. Simply put, plasmids are superpowers in a bottle. The first you acquire allows you to shoot electrical bolts directly from your hand. These bottles are filled with what is called Atom, a genetically modifying liquid that people can use to alter their bodies in a seemingly endless way. In terms of gameplay, this adds a lot of versatility and nuance to what could have been a pretty standard shooter. You can stun enemies in their tracks or electrify puddles, you can set enemies or pools of oil ablaze, and more. While this certainly adds a bit more fun to combat against the hordes of deranged, mutated maniacs that may get in your way, what always fascinated me was the realization of the meaning behind the choices of plasmids you were given. Plasmids are sold in vending machines, available throughout the city. While they take the unique currency of Atom, which is admittedly harder to come by, it still is available to the public at any time. What's odd about this is there aren't many plasmids that I would personally consider functional in a day-to-day use. For instance, if I had my options of plasmids, I would look for ones that, with a wave of a hand, all of my dirty dishes would be clean, or perhaps my laundry would fold itself. However, when looking throughout the plasmids, it's clear that most of them are designed with the intention of combat, self-defense, or to explicitly harm someone else. You could make the argument that some are designed with multifunctional purposes, like incinerate being capable of lighting a fireplace or perhaps a cigarette, but others are so narrow in their design that it's difficult to see a reason for it other than it being an aggressive weapon. For goodness sakes, there is a plasmid called Insect Swarm that releases a horde of angry killer bees that assault and sting your enemies. I don't see that having many other practical functions. Time to do my taxes? No problem, release the bees! This is only accentuated by the fact that every time you equip a new plasmid, there's an explanation played over a fun little cartoon depiction of the plasmid being used, and in every single one, it is shown in the context of using it offensively. There are plenty of plasmids to choose from, as long as you intend to use them for violence. Speaking of freedom and the choices you are supposedly allowed to make, there is the great moral dilemma of how you decide to interact with Rapture's little sisters. These twisted children have been brainwashed and genetically altered with one sole purpose: to gather Atom from the corpses littered around the city. These poor souls are accompanied by big daddies, who are similarly altered men grafted into grotesque armored diving suits. Their sole purpose is to protect the little sisters from any threat with deadly force. However, within the context of gameplay, the only way to gather Atom, which is required to purchase plasmids or important upgrades, is to kill the big daddy and then decide whether to rescue or harvest the little sister. Saving the little sister gives you less Atom overall, but spares the child and seemingly reverses the process of her transformation, while harvesting nets you more Atom, but kills her in the process. If you decide to rescue the child, then after a certain amount of little sisters are rescued, they will leave you gifts in the form of a teddy bear. These teddy bears are filled with more Atom, plasmids, and other items. Interestingly enough, from what I've read online from other players who were curious, because of the teddy bear gifts, you essentially gain the same amount of Atom despite which choice you make. Furthermore, the first time that you stumble upon this conundrum, you have two different characters arguing their opinions on what you should choose. Atlas, who up until this point has been your ally and a seemingly good moral compass, argues to harvest the little sisters, because down in Rapture, it's kill or be killed. On the other hand, Dr. Tenenbaum, the one who turned these poor girls into these brainwashed monsters, begs you to spare them. Atlas's whole argument is that you would be getting less Adam, but as we know, that isn't the truth. So instead of being a choice about practicality, it is one that is solely moral in a place that has thrown morality to the wind. However, we as the player are not like the degenerate dregs of Rapture and are left to make the decisions ourselves. These decisions between being a savior or a savage directly impact which ending you receive at the end of the game. Of course, we cannot discuss the themes of freedom and choices without addressing the shocking plot twist and the final confrontation with the big man himself, Andrew Ryan. It's revealed that you are, essentially, a brainwashed test tube baby. The man you're playing, Jack, with all the flashbacks and memories of family, has been nothing more than a clever machination by Fontaine, who has been posing as your companion, Atlas. You find a wall with the words, "Would you kindly," written across it, and the whole plot is laid before your eyes. Atlas hasn't been just directing you where to go, he's been commanding you every step of the way to do his bidding. This revelation culminates in you finally confronting Andrew Ryan. In his office, he begins another pompous speech, explaining the nature of your crafted existence while casually playing golf. All the while, he has started a sequence that will cause Rapture to self-destruct. Brainwashing aside, Ryan has been proven to be a narcissistic monster, so I find that most players would still enjoy ending him once and for all. However, even though you were armed to the teeth, both in terms of guns and plasmids, Andrew Ryan knows your commanding phrase. Before you know it, you lose control of your character and it enters into a cutscene between you and the would-be main villain of the story. Andrew flaunts his power over you, making you sit, stand, and run around, yet still trying to drive his point home, stating frequently, "A man chooses, a slave obeys." It's in this moment that Ryan seems to have the upper hand, poised over you with his golf club raised as if he intends to bring it down on your head, only to hand it to you and command that you kill. One strike after another, Andrew Ryan just repeats the phrase, "A man chooses, a slave obeys," until ultimately the killing blow is brought upon him. Once he is dead, Atlas commands you to take his key and stop Rapture from self-destructing. Upon doing so, Atlas reveals himself as Fontaine and mocks you. While the game continues on with Tenenbaum helping you break free from the brainwashing and you ultimately killing Fontaine, the plot twist and the scene with Andrew Ryan are the pinnacle of the themes of freedom and choices. Firstly, upon discovering that I had essentially been playing as a brainwashed zombie throughout Rapture, I had a bit of a gaming existential crisis. All my life, I have been following orders from NPCs and objective markers, jumping through dangers and toils just for my princess to be in another castle. Of course, even if I weren't compelled to obey the phrase, "Would you kindly," I probably would have done what Atlas told me to do regardless because, well, that's just what you do in video games. You're told what to do and you go do it to progress the game. While in the case of Bioshock, this works as an effective reinforcement of the narrative, the reality of other games is that there are usually too many limitations to just give the player total freedom. You don't play through Halo by negotiating with the Covenant as Master Chief, or defeat Bowser by taking him out with a sniper rifle. While those certainly would be interesting twists on those games, it doesn't fit the tone or vision of their stories. Even in games where you do seem to have some kind of choice, it's not uncommon to find out that despite what you pick, the game is going to play out in a certain way regardless. Throughout the entire journey of Rapture, we are shown, time and time again, how Andrew Ryan is a tyrannical monster. Once you finally get to him, it is revealed that you have been a puppet dragged along by strings, but that doesn't just magically make Andrew Ryan an innocent saint. This revelation, though, might make some people think twice about killing Andrew Ryan, but now, when we are most likely to hesitate, the choice is stripped away from our hands. I always thought it was bizarre to me that Andrew Ryan essentially kills himself. Honestly, for years, I didn't understand this. He knows exactly how to control the player. He could take control of me and force me to go drown myself. He could even turn me against Fontaine and use me as his secret weapon, but instead, he forces the player to beat him to death with his own golf club. The only logical rationalization that I can come up with is that Ryan knew his time was up one way or another, and he wanted to go by his own terms. Andrew repeats the phrase, "A man chooses, a slave obeys," over and over again until he's dead. I always thought of this as either him mocking your inability to disobey, or perhaps him trying to get you to break free from your chains, but I only took this point of view because I was focusing on the second half of the phrase, "A slave obeys." If we, the player, are forced to obey, then it is only logical that the contrast is found within Andrew himself, choosing his own death. Andrew Ryan is able to find victory, not in the form of violence or strength, but in the metaphysical philosophy that he lives by. It's his choice to die, and we, once again, are forced to be pulled by our strings. I will say, as compelling as this final stand is, there could be an argument made that he could have just forced the player to stand by in a corner and wait for the self-destruct sequence to complete. This way, he chooses to die by his own hand, the player is forced to obey, and ultimately Fontaine loses in the end. While this makes more sense coming from an evil mastermind like Ryan, I get that they wanted to have a final showdown with Fontaine and couldn't wrap up the game this way. Even the great Andrew Ryan isn't totally free after all. After hunting down and defeating Fontaine, we are then greeted by a little sister. As I mentioned earlier, depending on whether you rescue or harvest little sisters will impact the ending of the game. Having rescued the sisters, or even partially rescuing the sisters, you are treated with a lovely little cutscene. It depicts a little sister growing up and living a full life, and while you are laying on your deathbed, you were surrounded by the girls that you saved. However, if you harvested every little sister you came across, the narration turns darker and it is explained that you took over Rapture for yourself. Of course, your ambition can't be satiated and you release an army of splicers upon the surface world, presumably waging war and potentially taking it over. At first, you might find yourself concluding that some of our choices in the game really did matter after all. At least, that's how I felt after learning about the bad ending. That is, until you think about the fact that there is a sequel. Bioshock 2 takes place 8 years after the first game. While there is certainly a lot of references to the first game, I imagine it would be a totally different story if the surface world was overrun by splicers. According to what I've read online, the good ending is canon, due to a specific reference in Burial at the Sea, Episode 2, making the bad ending essentially non-existent. This simply means that our choices, consequences, and ultimately freedom and rapture are all an illusion. A man chooses, a slave obeys. Now, if you enjoyed the video, would you kindly subscribe to the channel and check out my other stuff? Playing through Bioshock again was a lot of fun for me, so if you're interested in me covering Bioshock 2 and/or Infinite, let me know down below in the comments. In all seriousness, I appreciate you watching if you made it this far. I talk about games here on the channel, and I'm always excited when people share their opinions with me on the game at hand. Have a great day, and stay magical.